This is a very good example in which we are required to calculate the effective stress at point A, which is 5 meters below the ground surface. So this point A is in the clay layer. And as you see that the thickness of this clay layer is 20 meters, we have a groundwater level right on the surface at the same level. And in addition to that, there is a layer of gravel underneath the clay. And this layer is under artesian pressure. We know this because if we draw a piezometer and then we'll measure the water level, it will be 10 meters above the groundwater level. So we have groundwater level here and we have another level here. So what we're required to do is to estimate pore water pressure at point A. And after that, we will estimate the effective stress at point A. So this is not as simple as it looks like, because in addition to the hydrostatic pore water pressure at point A, we're going to have additional pore water pressure that will come from this upper seepage. So because this layer of gravel, it's under pressure. So we have additional water flow in the upper direction. And this additional water flow will contribute. So this is going to be delta U. It will contribute to the total pore water pressure at point A. So let's start with the first step. And the first step is pretty simple. We need to estimate the total stress and we need to estimate the hydrostatic pore water pressure. So we'll start with the total stress. Total stress, it's a unit weight of soil times the depth to the point A. So in this case, we know that the unit weight of clay is 20 kilonewtons per cubic meters. And to point A takes 5 meters. So in this case, the total stress at point A will be 100 kilonewtons per square meters. So now let's estimate the hydrostatic pressure at point A. And I'm going to write a U with a zero. So in this case, just imagine if there is no any additional upper seepage, so we don't have any layer of gravel. Just imagine for a second this, and then let's calculate pore water pressure. In this case, pore water pressure is unit weight of water times the height of the water above point A. So in this case, if we have groundwater level at the same level as ground surface, we still have 5 meters of HW, and the ground and the unit weight of water, it's 9.81 times 5. It will give us approximately 49.1 kilonewtons per square meters. Okay, next step is to estimate the hydraulic gradient of this soil mass. To do that, we just need to remember the formula for hydraulic gradient. It's delta H divided by L. So in this case, we need to find first delta H. And the way to do it, we just need to look at two water levels. So this is the first water level, this is the second water level. So because we have high water level in gravel, it's 10 meters above the ground water level. So it means that water is going to flow this way. So, and this also means that delta H is going to be 10 meters, which is basically the difference between this level and this water level, 10 meters. And now we need to estimate L. In this case, we know that for this whole layer of clay, water starts flowing from the bottom of the layer and goes all the way up to the top. So that will give us L. And in this case, L is going to be the thickness of the clay layer, which is 20 meters. And will give us 0.5. Next step is to determine the excess pore water pressure. After that, we'll be able to calculate total pore water pressure. And after that, we'll estimate the effective stress at point A. So we already know that the hydraulic gradient for the whole clay layer is 0.5, which means that if we take point A or any point, let's say here, point B or point C, for each point, hydraulic gradient is going to be the same. Doesn't change. What it changes though, it's delta H, which is a difference in water levels. So in this case, we will see that the maximum delta H is going to be at the bottom of the clay layer because the upward seepage starts from here. And in this case, delta H is going to be equal to 10 meters. So that's the maximum value. Then as water flows up to the groundwater level here, this delta H will dissipate. And when it goes to the groundwater level, delta H becomes zero because there is no more upward seepage in the clay layer. So what we need to decide is how much delta H is left at point A. And that will give us additional pore water pressure. So if we find this delta H at point A, we should be able to find additional pore water pressure at point A as delta H at point A times unit weight of water. So now let's look at the formula of hydraulic gradient. It's delta H divided by L. And from here we can get that delta H is equal hydraulic gradient times L. Now let's try to apply this formula for point A. So in this case, we can write it as delta H at point A. It's a hydraulic gradient times a distance at point A. So we know that when it flows till point A, so delta H dissipated this much, so this much was already wasted, so and only this much is left. So what we're going to say that LA is going to be 5 meters, because that's how much is left for water to flow from point A to the groundwater level. And now we can find delta HA. Hydraulic gradient is still the same, 0.5 times LA is 2.5 meters. It will give us 2.5 meters. So this additional head caused by this upward seepage from the gravel layer will give additional 2.5 meters to the pore water pressure at point A. So now let's find this additional pore water pressure at point A. It's delta H at point A times unit weight of water, and that will give us 2.5 times 9.81. It's equal to 24.5 kilonewtons per square meters. So now we have this additional pore water pressure. We can find total pore water pressure, which is hydrostatic pore water pressure plus additional pore water pressure at point A. The hydrostatic pore water pressure is 49.1 plus additional 24.5. will give us 73.6 kilonewtons per square meters. And now we should be able to find the effective stress. Effective stress is total stress minus pore water pressure. Total stress, we already know, it's 100. The total pore water pressure at point A is 73.6, which will give us 26.4 kilonewton per square meters. And this is the answer for this problem.